my kitchen. Guess what I brought you? A baker's dozen. Oh my goodness, I can't see you. Well, how are they supposed to get their baker's dozen? Oh dear me, Brenda, you're gonna have to help me. I'm all messed up. We're all counted out. And we have a baker's dozen for all of you. So how many is in a baker's dozen?
13.
Oh, you guys are so good. So this is what you're supposed to do now. The first person in the aisle is supposed to take one and pass it on. You thought you were going to get the whole bag. Okay, Aiko, can you help me?
Yes.
Or should it be Linda, because she understands?
I understand.
Here, I know, but Linda counted it. Come on. Linda's going to help me. Yeah. Oh my goodness, we had this all rehearsed. What happened?
I think I have the wrong bag.
Huh? Well, it's fine. It was gonna be fun, but now we're all messed up. But guess what? There's a Valentine for all of you. Aw. Okay, here. I quit. I'm going to be just like the Pope. If the Pope can retire, I can too. Hello, everybody. Guess what? I'm on my blue spot. This is where I'm supposed to be. What's that? I wear pants. You didn't know I wear pants? This is my chef outfit. See, it says Chef L. And guess what we're going to do with a baker's dozen?
Make cookies.
Make cookies. What are we going to do with our baker's dozen?
Make a quilt.
We're going to make a quilt. A baker's dozen of fat quarters. You got it. It's a baker's dozen of fat quarters. Now we're getting together. I think that we had the opening just right, huh? So I saw some of you already looked in your bag. Did you look in your bag for your baker's dozen? So I have to make sure it's the right one. Guess what I have? You, inside your bag, you have a little M&M chip cookie. And this is my M&M quilt. Get it? Oh, yeah, you can applaud. It's okay. Thank you. M&M's, yellow, orange. The black is for the chocolate. Do you like chocolate? You should all eat a lot of dark chocolate because now it's good for you. Next week it might not be. So feast on all of the dark chocolate that you can. And then right in the center, see all the little polka dots? More M&M's, little white M&M's. The quilt is called Hole in the Wall. Yes?
Yes.
It looks like a hole in the wall. Very modern. And with all of the little yellow prints, this is what I liked. I liked all of the bright colors. I'm getting old. Get it? The older you get, the brighter you look. So this is my quilt. This is the rendition that I did today. And now we're going to pass that on to Teresa. And Sue gets to show her quilt. Because she actually created the pattern. This is Sue Bouchard. This is
Hello.
My assistant.
Yay.
Yeah, the hole in the wall.
There's your spot. So anyway, this is my quilt. I was really excited to kind of venture out from the non-traditional style of quilting. I had these fabrics from a designer named Marcia Dersey. She does fabrics for Troy Corporation. And she started out just doing hand paintings, and this fabric manufacturer picked them up. And I just thought they were so beautiful, but I didn't want to cut them up into little teeny pieces. So I thought this would be a great way to showcase the fabrics. And it kind of, I've been following the modern quilters lately, and they actually started about 15 years ago. They started back east, and now they have guilds all throughout the country. And I just became a member of the San Diego County Modern Quilt Guild. And it's kind of funny, because I go in there, and they have a lot of things that we were doing 20 years ago, like two-piecing, and to them it's all new, you know? But they take a modern twist on it, and that's what I think is so fun about it, just kind of freshen up the whole style. Is they're kind of like the asymmetrical things. Like maybe they'll take like one big block and then a half of a block, and that's all they have on their quilt. It's a lot of negative space that they use just to kind of showcase how pretty the designs are. So anyway, this is my quilt. I hope you like it.
Cool. So if it's a baker's dozen, then how many blocks are there?
Well, there are 12 blocks.
How many blocks are there?
13.
How many blocks are there?
12.
12. And where's the 13th one?
Middles.
In the middle.
So that is actually the lap size quilt, and this is a smaller quilt that you could use as a crib quilt or something. This chartreuse is kind of the new in color, in case you didn't know. I'm deciding if I like it yet or not.
But I'm surprised if you don't too.
Yeah, I think it's kind of fun. It's kind of fun, but I really like the prints, the bicycles, and the bird cages, and the little giraffes and everything. So this is the other size that's featured in the pattern. Alrighty. Alrighty. Okay, so this is Teresa's quilt. You want to get the mic and talk about it?
Ooh, that's good. Make noise. Ooh, be noisy.
I think Sue said it all. I started picking up headquarters, just anything I liked, and then went together and has such a high contrast. And then as I'm putting it on the wall, I just tell Eleanor, it's a beautiful sunset, isn't it? Yes. That's what I call it. So I agree so much that you want to show your fabrics, and that's what I picked that for. Okay?
It's very pretty.
And the black really sets it off, doesn't it? So now you see the 12 and the 13 is in the center.
Yes.
Baker's dozen. Cool. All right, let me see which one we have. Oh!
The next quilt, this is made by Heidi. This is Carol that works in her store. This is her daughter. And she really liked this pattern a lot, and she asked if she could make a sample. So a lot of times when we go out to shows and we have these two store locations, we never have enough samples. So she's going to let us use this for a few months, probably a year. but this is a really good contrast. How Teresa's being the sunset. She named her something to do with the sunrise, so I thought that was really nice. But I thought she did a really good job picking her colors and then the constant in the middle as well.
And Rick, I'm not sure. Okay, he's close on the close-up, but notice how she did like an eclipse around it in the very center. It's really striking.
Yeah.
It's simple quilting, and then actually rays in the squares going out.
Yeah.
It's really beautiful. Perfect. Yeah, good. Show your appreciation.
You want to give me your mic?
Yes.
Okay.
Changing of mics.
Check your
filter. Make sure you get on your blue spot, too, because I'm on mine.
Okay.
Patty's off of her spot.
Okay.
You're going to get in trouble. Oh, we're trading. Mm-hmm. Is that what we're doing? Okay, let's trade.
Okay.
You go on my spot.
I'll stand in your spot.
This is very technical here.
I'm the chef.
Ooh, is this one pretty?
Okay.
Very pretty.
So, I guess, as you can imagine, I thought those colors made me feel happy. They're playful. They're whimsical, almost childlike. And, of course, if you know me, I don't like to follow directions. I, first of all, compared to the other ones.
And this is Rick.
Yeah. Thank you, Rick. Okay. One thing, if you notice, I did two alternating colors in the center square. And then
it's when, 14.
Uh-oh. Have to rewrite the pattern. Oh, my gosh. Here's Ben. And then when I was arranging my blocks, I wanted the colors to be balanced, so I repeated the colors throughout, and I introduced colors in the cornerstones. Ben stole the show. So I, as I was working on my quilt, It reminded me of a painting. You know, I was an art teacher when I was in school, art history. We talked about this artist. His name is Mondrian. He did a painting called Broadway Boogie Woogie, which when I saw that quilt, I started thinking about Mondrian. And his painting, do we have a picture of the Broadway Boogie Woogie?
We have Mondrian.
Mondrian. He's here.
He's here. Yay.
There he is. And Broadway Boogie Woogie. We hear the little boogie woogie in the background. Well,
hey, hold.
Mondrian.
He's next.
Oh, yeah. Mondrian. He came from he was a Dutch painter in the 1940s, war going on in Europe. He came to the United States, lived in Manhattan, loved the city, the layout of the city, if you can kind of it represents the, the painting compared with the painting, you see how the larger squares represent the city blocks of Manhattan.
These are the city blocks?
And then those little squares represent the traffic going through the city.
Streets.
And he did alternating warm and cool colors, which sets up a rhythm. Warm and cool. It creates movement when you put those colors together. And to him, it represented the boogie-woogie music, the beat, the rhythm. So that's why I was thinking about Mondrian.
And what are these?
Those are...
squares.
The kitchen.
The buildings.
Yeah, that's the kitchen. There's got to be a restroom in every room.
Maybe that's a restroom. Little square in the middle.
Yeah, at least one.
Okay, so then I started thinking about my hero. This is another painter. His name is Joseph Albers. He's from, he was born in Germany in 1888. And he moved to the United States. Oh, so you can see
there.
So this
we're learning
book,
as we go.
Yeah, this is the story of Joseph Albers, An Eye for Color. And it's actually written by his neighbor. When he moved to Connecticut, there was a young girl. He was an elderly gentleman. Not yet, Al. There was an elderly, her neighbor was Joseph Albers. He was a painter. And when she became an adult, she wrote a story about him. Her name is Natasha Wing. And this is actually written for children, but it's an easy read for everyone, I think. But he also was exploring the effects of color. You can see this was inspired by architecture. And then... when he was 61 years old, he started painting squares. And he painted over 1,000 squares. They were all a square and a square. But he was exploring the effects of color. When you put one color next to another, things happen. You get optical effects, magical things happen. And he wrote it all down. Here's some more. There's his picture of his square in a square series. He painted for 27 years. And at the end of his life, well, actually, when he died at the age of 88, he was still painting squares. I think that's a message for quilters, because this inspires me. When I'm working on a quilt, that's what I'm always thinking about. How do those colors interact with one another? So I ordered his book. He compiled a book. And look at the size of this book. I ordered the book through the mail, and I pick it up. I can hardly lift it. I mean, it's heavy. And there are two volumes. And... oh, let's get it out. But it's all the things he learned from his work with the color, the square and a square. And to me, these are, each one of them could inspire a quilt, just the way he worked with the colors. And you can see all the different effects that are created. here, this one I love. I said, oh, I love those colors. Couldn't you see that made into a quilt? So this he called, did I tell you it's called Homage to a Square? That series he did. So I said, well, I'm going to do my own little version, Homage to a Square. So these are my scraps. Now you can show it.
Now, you ready?
Yeah. Watch out, there's a pin. But these are my leftovers. And I was playing with those little squares that when you put different colors together, different things happen. And let me see if I can show you. So you can see when
like
you put
a
complementary colors together, complements, obviously are opposites on the color wheel. They make things intensify. Or if you put quilt colors that are side by side on the color wheel, they blend harmoniously. So there's just so much you can do just by playing with color.
Like that. Cool. So this is your leftovers,
you.
Huh?
Little art class.
Good.
Did you know? Did you all know I was an art teacher? And I guess I've told you that before. But I noticed Eleanor found a picture. What happened to that picture?
It was supposed to be a surprise.
Well,
am I allowed to get off my blue spot? Okay. I'm going to show you what I found this morning.
I couldn't believe it.
Okay, move over.
Okay, we'll trade
You weren't
places.
Supposed to see that.
Well, it was sitting under right in my face.
I know, but look. Look at this. Aww.
I think I was in high school.
Did you paint that picture?
That's Bernard Buffet. I did a copy. So
we're good at copying, aren't we?
Did when we learned
guess
when
who this
we
is.
Were learning art, you would do a copy of something. Oh, there's
me. Oh, there's what's her face.
Okay.
Good. How did we do? Did we inspire you? And so you know all about Keller? I think I'm back in my spot now, and which is the next one. Do you believe this? We had so much time to make all these samples. We're going crazy. So let me see what this one is.
Well, this is about your fabric line.
No, but where's your quilt?
Rick, they're telling me that your camera is blurry.
Where's Honey?
Oh, we already showed it.
Oh, yeah. You know what? We forgot to...
We showed Honey. You didn't even...
Honey, and you forgot to sing your
You
song.
Didn't even tell... I didn't... You didn't even say Honey.
Okay, back up. We're going back to Honey.
Cut. Retake. Retake. Did you even mention
I forgot to tell you the most important thing of all.
That's what happens when you get old.
Get on your spot.
The name of the fabric is...
Honey. Do you get it? Does it sound like a song to you?
Sugar.
I nearly missed it. more salvages, and we do have these for sale in the store in case any of you want to get these salvages. We have lots of salvages in all different colors. In fact, look at the lovely colors. Ooh, I know what this line is called. Have you seen it? Oh, now I have to fix my hair. Whose fabric is this? It's mine. It's Ellie Ann. It's our new fabric line called Ellie Ann. Ta-da! And, of course, you can get it in a baker baker's dozen. Of course, 13 fat quarters. Is that pretty? It's called periwinkle. And Teresa made that one. Oops, get on your spots. You're not on your blue
your
line.
Your space.
We never know what's going to happen. It used to be whatever happened in the room stayed in the room. Doesn't happen anymore. Now everybody all around the world knows I can't stand on my blue spot.
So Teresa anyhow, made this quilt.
Anyhow, is that pretty?
Yes.
That Teresa made that one. It's very pretty. That one is called Periwinkle. Oh, guess where you can get it. In 13, a baker's dozen. Baker's dozen. And this one I did, this one is the pink line. And I did this one specifically because of the fussy cuts. The fussy cuts. And so I put a fussy cut in each one of the blocks. How many blocks?
12.
One more time. How many blocks?
12.
And where's the 13th?
The middle.
In the hole in the middle. Yay, you're getting it. You're going to pass it. That one's cool. And that one is called pink. Pink paradise.
Okay, this one
is that
have.
Pretty?
This one we
yes.
Don't have the orange. We're going to fake it.
Pink paradise. Oh, we don't have the mango one?
No.
All right. Look how pretty the mango is. Isn't that pretty? Would you two hold up the mango? It's lovely.
Huh? Yeah, Patty's wearing it.
Patty's wearing it.
Yeah, you can be
the
our
mango.
Quilt.
The mango. All right, we're doing good. And then this is the one that Sue did. Ta-da! And this one is called Ellie's Bouquet. Aw, isn't that cute? Places.
Yeah, you need to move up.
Oh, it's me. Ellie's Bouquet. And so Sue took a sampling from all of the different colorways and put them all together. They work, huh? Yeah. Would you think that the orange worked with pink or the mango worked with the pink?
Orange works with
beautiful.
Everything.
Pardon me?
Orange works with everything.
Orange. Sue's been trying to convince me of that. But actually, I think we shouldn't call it orange. We should call it mango.
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 Or tangerine. I've been calling
lovely,
it tangerine,
huh?
Too.
Or tangerine or persimmon. Doesn't that look like a persimmon, too? See, it looks really good. So cool. So do we have enough hole in the wall?
We have enough for now. That's
we have enough for now. Okay. I get to move off my spot because I'm going to sew.
Here, let me take
this. Does anybody want to take care of my hat? While we're gone. Oh, my gosh. So, I don't know
thank
about you,
you
but this isn't quite how I thought the table would be. Let us move it all around. Let us get this all ready. Okay, so look at that. Whoa, what do they call that? A tower? A tower of all the colors. I'm going to put something here for you to look at. So, it's called Ellie Ann. And my name is Eleanor Ann. They call me Elle, but I have a granddaughter who is also Eleanor Ann, and they call her Ellie. But none of us are called Ellie Ann. But I pulled this picture because I thought, oh, there she is, the baby. She is my oldest granddaughter, but I just want to show you. If we look at the little baby, and here I am with Patty. And I'm on the left, and my two little right there. Can you see me? So do you start to see a similarity? Okay, look at this. Now look at us. What do you think? She looks like me. I think she does. And it's funny, Grant walked through the building one day, and he saw a picture of me, and he picked it up and said, I just realized what my daughter's going to look like. But it's kind of scary because she's been watching me perform, and she did her own little YouTube the other day. She's been watching me, and there are a lot of things of me on my YouTube that I did not want anybody to see, especially my granddaughter. Okay, so now we're going to go on your pattern. Got your pattern? Okay, so we've got to do some cutting. And, oh, Vanna, you don't even have a quilt to show. Whew. All right, we're going to do this fast. So, the first thing we're going to cut are the strips. Oh, maybe you should put it up on the design wall. Yeah, put it up on the design wall. We didn't practice this, huh? Okay, so the first thing I'm going to do is the strips for around the square. And I'm doing this because I got confused. And you know how easy it is to get confused now? Yes? Are you worrying about that? Well, there's two different sizes of strips in this quilt. And they look about the same size. And so this is what I'm going to tell you. The strips around the 13th dozen, or the centers. Doo-doo. Thank you, Vanna. Would you show that again? Do you Doo-doo. See those strips? Okay, see those strips? Okay, they are start out as 2-inch strips. And so what I did, I took my fabric, because I have my Shape Cut Plus, and I'm just cutting these up into 2-inch strips. 2-inch strips. Oh, yes. I asked for a nice sharp ruler cutter, and I got it.
I thought you checked it.
I didn't check it. You didn't check it either. None of us checked our rotary cutter. The first thing that you should have is a sharp rotary cutter, one that will go through your fabric. Very useful. I can just see all the letters for that. Oh, well, let's just take this
here,
and get rid
it
of
me,
it.
Please.
We all try to make it last. It's extremely
hot. We talked about
checking.
The last one that used that.
I am completely done with this baker coat. I am dying. I am stripping. Ta-da! And now, Orion, you must gussing me up. Oops, that was my mic. Okay, how do I look? Take that away. And the next shape I want to cut, the next strip, now that I have stripped, I'm going to take my background fabric. And Vanna, would you please point to the next size?
Right here.
There, yes, there.
And all these.
And all of those. The last one was what size?
2.
And now we're going to do 2.5. Oh, I have a new cutter just like that. It's magic. Let's see if I can do it. You know what? I never know what's going to happen on here, but it's good that I can just go with the flow, don't you think? Okay, so
fun.
Now I'm switching because now I have the Shape Cut Plus, or Shape Cut Pro, the Shape Cut Pro that only cuts 2.5 inches. You would be surprised at how wonderful it is when you have a sharp blade, and I have a completely new cutter, and I don't want to mess it up. Are you laughing at me, Patricia? It cut! Okay, so now I'm going to take these, and I'm going to cut into 2.5 inch by 10 inch. 2.5 inch by 10 inch because I need that for my blocks. All right?
Well, you also had your other cutter just in case. Isn't that for this cutting the strips?
I could. I could use that one, couldn't I? Let's see if it's sharp. Yes. Let us see if we can do this. All right. So I'm going to line it up at 10. Oh, my goodness. It is amazing what you can do when you have a sharp cutter. You know what? Heidi. Oh, Heidi is working in the store. She's so adorable. She was having a hard time cutting. And so I said, you need a new blade. And she said, well, this blade didn't break yet. She said, I was going to replace it when it broke. I said, how long have you been using that blade, Heidi? She said, 1 year. So guess where you can get new blades? Here. You can get new blades, huh? Okay, so now I did really good. I cut the 2 inch for the center, the 2.5 inch for inside the blocks. And now, what about the center itself? What size is that? Who's looking? 4.5. Oh, you guys are good. After we got past the first question, you've gotten along better. So now, see, it says, so you take the 13th from the baker dozen, choose one of that out of the baker dozen. This is the 13th one for your center square, and you cut it into 4.5-inch pieces. And this is that cool ruler that I got last week that I'm still learning how to use because I didn't get a cut at the end. And how many 4.5-inch squares do I need? 12. I need 12. All right. So you can cut 2 strips out of 1 fat quarter and then just turn it around this way. Doo-doo. Line it up. Stack it up. And cut again. And you won't have any waste. How's that? And this ruler is 4.5 inches. And last time I told you that, I got it from Tacony. And they called and thanked me because their phone is ringing off the hook. And they're all sold out. And they won't have any.
Until May.
Until May. But look how nice you can cut up 4.5-inch squares with it.
That's great.
Ta-da! 12 perfect ones. Get rid of that. And now. Ooh. Fondle it. Smell it.
It really is nice fabric if you haven't had a chance to touch it.
If we had anybody out there, they would be listening to us and going, what is going on in that class? Everybody go, ooh. So what I'm going to do is divide my fat quarters into groups of 3. So I have 4 different groups of 3, right? And I'm just going to stack them up with the salvage edge all at the bottom. Oh, the salvage edge. There's that little purse that I had around here.
Right,
you got to save all your salvage edges now because our friend Sandy wrote this little book on how to just save all of your salvage edges and sew them together. And I didn't have one with my name on it. So now I have one. But isn't that cute? That's Sandy's book. And she likes to save all the salvages. It gets scary. A fabric shop will not survive if you guys all just make things out of salvages, huh?
Did you finish the 2 inch? Those 2 inch ones, doesn't she need?
It's by Cozy. By Cozy. Down right down Cozy Quilts. Right down in San Diego. Sandy Thompson is our friend. And her book is one of the best sellers in the country right now. Is that cool? Is that neat? Cheer for Sandy.
Yay!
All right. Okay, so now this is what I'm going to do. I am on page 3, and I'm going to start cutting up my fat quarters. And we worked really hard. Sue and I worked really hard because I found out that it didn't work for me, and I had to do my cutting over again. I had stripes, and I didn't like the way my stripes looked.
Like these stripes right in the background? I don't know if you can go close. Or these stripes?
But look at those. They look continuous, don't they?
Mm-hmm.
They were continuous. So this cutting works for stripe or non-stripe.
Yay!
Is that good? That's good because you're going to get some stripes. Okay, so the first thing, I have my salvage across the bottom. I have all of my pieces lined up on my board, and I'm just going to straighten off the salvage edge. Okay, I put a little mark up here. No, I'm sorry. Cut! I'm just straightening the edge. Because the salvage is still there. See that little sliver? We make our artists draw little slivers. This is what the little sliver is. This is not enough for anything.
Yes, it is.
It's enough to throw.
Oh, it is.
It's enough to stuff dog beds.
Yes.
Oh, it's good for stuffing dog beds. Okay, so the first strip that I'm going to cut is how long? Can you look?
3 by 10.
Can you see on that big picture? This is where we're looking at, right here. The first one I'm going to cut off is 10 inches. You're right. A 10 inch. And then the next one beside it is
7.
Who said that? Yay! You're reading the book. So I'm cutting this into 2 big sections real fast. Ta-da! Get rid of this. Okay, now I'm going back to the first one that's 10 inches wide. And I'm going to turn it around the other way, and I'm going to cut little rows that are how wide?
3 inches.
You guys are getting good. All right. So there's the 3-inch pieces. Yeah?
Yes.
3 by 10. And guess what? This is extra. You can use it for your backing. But
we have lots of options.
Yes, we have lots of options. Teresa, do you have your little option handy? Oh, this is what Teresa did. She took that little hunk of fabric and she cut it all into 5-inch pieces. And this is what she made from her leftovers.
I like it.
Isn't that amazing?
And put a corner so you only use 4 strips and borders.
10. Okay. Whoops. Whoops. Can you read her lips? She didn't have
a
mic.
I'm sorry.
Read her lips. All right.
That is from the leftovers that you, Eleanor just showed you. And I realized I could cut it. I cut it 5 inches one way and the other way 5 inches twice. And that's all the squares in it. And it did take me an hour and about a half an hour to put the borders on it. And I was relaxing going away on Friday, and Orion came and said, Teresa, you need to help me with these orders. So I had to leave it aside, and then I came back and finished it really, really fast.
And so while she was telling you, I went and I cut my 7-inch wide piece into 2 10-inch pieces. So now these are 7 by 10, and I have 2 of them. Good? And I have a little bit left over. And now you can get rid of that one. And so now it comes for Star Wars. I cleared off my table. I'm going to sew.
Oop.
Whoops. Do 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 do. Commercial, stop just right. Oh, that's pretty good, huh?
Yeah.
Speechless. Oh my goodness, I even did it pretty good. I'm about 1/4 inch off, and now this will take me about an hour to get the 1/4.
Can you just give me the controller?
Oh. No, I'm good. I'm good. Yay. All right, we're doing good. All right. So, Sue, let's see. I need some of the 1-inch pieces.
The 2-inch?
The 2-inch.
Here you go.
Yes, it's the 2-inch. All right. You want to sew?
Yes.
1/4 inch. 1/4 inch. But you know what? It doesn't matter this time if it's a perfect quarter, but it should be straight. Huh? Being straight is good. And consistent is good. That's really good. Okay. And I think we're supposed to cut these in half, right? Right?
Uh-huh.
Yep. Okay, so I am starting on the center squares. Did you turn the page? Beep. Page 4. So what do we need? We need what size strips, what size lattice? 2 inch. And what size are the center squares?
4.5.
4.5. Yay. So if you just lay out a... I wasn't supposed to cut these into little squares. Why didn't you stop me?
I didn't know what colors you were doing. These are pink.
I pretended I was fussy cutting. I did that before, and I said, I don't want to do that again. You weren't supposed to cut them. Look, I have a strip. Good.
Wait, make sure it's long enough. Make sure it's long enough.
Oh, my goodness.
It's got to be 9.
Oh, it's got to be 9. It's right on. Don't worry. It's right on.
Do you want it just to cut a 4.5
inch? Is that why you brought that out, Teresa? You had to let me be embarrassed, and you didn't yell, stop, stop.
There you go.
I was having such fun cutting my squares and showing off, and I wasn't even supposed to do that. Pardon me? It was the new blade. It's just so orgasmic. I just can't help it. Don't listen to me. Oh, my goodness. Now we have to go all back the whole way to cutting 4.5-inch strips.
Yay.
And now, look at the picture. When you look at the picture, you know what you're supposed to do.
Picture
I always good. Say that people don't read my books. I spend a lot of time writing all those words. And I say, all you guys do is look at the pictures. Yeah. And I should have just looked at the pictures. All right, I am on page 4. Right? And I have 2-inch, 4.5-inch, 2-inch. Yes?
Yes?
And these are for the?
Centers.
And you know what I did. Don't cut them into little?
Squares. Your teeth.
First.
It's a fussy cut.
Teeth.
Unless it's a fussy cut. Okay. 1/4-inch seam, pedal to the metal. Is your iron hot? Check it, Sue.
It's pretty hot.
Good. Power. Okay, I'm using a 1/4-inch, but I usually leave my machine set at about 15 stitches to the inch. It's a fairly small stitch because I keep on cutting across, and every time you cut through your stitches, it would be really cool if it didn't come apart, right? So I'm just using that small stitch. And 1/4-inch seam, I did down one side. Don't even bat an eye. I mean, now I'm on a roll, right? Yep. So now I'm just going to add a second strip to the other side. Yay, pedal. Go for it. So tell me, did you have a good weekend? Did you know we had snow in Julian? Yes. Were you jealous? You weren't jealous? I drove up to Julian on Friday night in Orion's little Prius, and I had white knuckles. I couldn't even go the whole way. I had to stop in Santa Isabel, call Brian, and have him come with chains and a 4-wheel drive. And I got up there, what fun we had. And so on Sunday, now Sue is setting the seams, and she is going to open and press into the background. So, Eric, now's the time you put on Kylie and Orion playing in the snow. Oh, Eric! There they are! Is that cute? They came up. It was the first time that probably Kylie remembers. They built a little snowman. It was adorable. But look how tough she looks, that little girl in her pink.
She looks really cute.
She looks really cute. It was really fun.
Orion looks cute, too.
Aww.
It really looks like she hit me hard, huh?
Yeah.
Being taken down by a 2.5-year-old.
Oh, fun. Too much fun. All right, so it's looking good. I'm checking your work, Sue. You did a good job.
Good.
You passed the test. Okay, so I am going to cut this now into 4.5-inch sections. So I'm just going to square off the left edge. I'm going to use my handy-dandy ruler that is 4.5 inches wide. Is this cool? Yeah. I'm really finding a lot of uses for it. But you need to cut one center for each block, and that would be? Yes! Not one person said 13. I'm really excited. All right, so we're just going to take this. This is our the two on the top. Okay, now I'm on page 5. And now, Miss Sue, I need to have more 2-inch.
They're over by you.
It's here, right here.
And those are not cut in half.
No, they're not. But look, they're nice and long. So I'm just going to take and lay one strip. They're going to go right in the middle. I'm going to flip this right sides together. And you see, you would just assembly line so. Like that. Okay, I'll really sew. I'm imitating Patty, but she left. Oh!
I think the instructions say 1/2 inch between.
Oh, you are absolutely right, Orion, to leave about 1/2 inch in between. I told them to tell me if I forgot stuff, and I said I would listen this time. I've been accused of not listening. Okay, so you've got one done. You're going to pick up the second one. You're going to leave approximately 1/2 inch in between, and you just keep on going. And just zip right down there. And use matching thread. Don't use red thread. I'm doing that just so you guys can see. That's some one time a woman said, I don't like that girl. She uses red thread all the time. So anyhow, so I'm just going to cut off right here. I have 2 done. You would do all 12. And now you just are going to open it up. And basically, you have to add a strip to the other side. So I am just going to go ahead and let's flip it over because I would rather have the block on the top. Wouldn't you? I would rather have the block on the top and just keep it straight, kind of keep it straight, putting it right across there. And Sue, get ready because I am going to use the 9.5-inch square up ruler.
I know where that is.
God.
It is pretty wonderful.
This is pretty wonderful. We like to know where our stuff is. Ta-da! And so, are you all going to celebrate Valentine's Day in one way or another? Yeah? All right. And, okay, 1, 2, 3, now, I did it. All right, so I am just going to go ahead and cut in between, and then I'm going to let you press the seams open, and then I'll show you how to just square it up, okay?
Okay.
I'm just going to give them to you, press them open, done with this, done with this, done with this. Good, we're doing good. Are we doing good?
Yes.
So you know how to do that, right? Okay, so now you have that little extra. I find that the 9.5-inch square up ruler is very useful right now. And you always put one in the upper right corner as long as you're right-handed. And if you just line this up, this square is approximately 7.5 inches. So right on these two sides right now, I'm just going to cut off these two little guys and then just going to turn it around and put it right on there nice and square. Again, get it as square as I can at 7.5 and just trim off the other side. It's perfect!
Yay!
Woo-hoo! You got it? Somebody said.
And I think you used the turnable.
Is
this why you have it?
Not for this one.
I think it's for the fussy cat.
It's for the fussy cat. Yeah, but you could use that. Okay, so one more turn, and just zip it. And this doesn't take a lot of time, but just remember these are all the 2-inch strips. All right, now we're going on. I'm going to use this medium blue, periwinkle blue. Ooh, set these aside. All right, so now I'm going to make the side rectangles. Remember you had those 3 by 10 inch, and now you're just going to work one block at a time. I put out the 2 3 by 10s, and in between I'm going to put this 3 by 10. Does it look like the book? Number, page 7?
Is it 3 by 10 or 2.5?
2.5.
2.5 by 10.
Well, this is 3 by 10, and this is
2.5.
2.5 by 10. By the time we're done, you're going to have this memorized, huh? So let me ask you. So we're going to flip it right sides together. When you went home and you were making your zigzag, did you sit with your little pom-pom and go, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 1. Did you do it?
Yes.
With your coffee? So get it right. You're going to have the baker's dozen when you're doing this one, so that you get all of them right, get all your 2s and your 2.5 inches in the right spot. Oops, let me see. Okay, go. It is useful to have thread in your needle, and I do. This is really good. Thread, so straight. Okay, you are gonna make this for all 12 blocks. If you wanna do it one at a time, or if you wanna do it assembly line, that's good, but you're gonna make it for all 12, okay? So we got this one, and what do you think? And how are you gonna press the seams, Sue?
Away from the 2.5 inch strips.
Away from the 2.5 inch. It's actually away from, like, if you just put it right on the top. And you can set the seams, and then, oh, come on.
You're still connected.
I could tell. There, set your seams. Set your seams and now open and just press into it.
I was going to say the background, but they're not all white backgrounds, so. Ah.
So set the seam and just open and press. Isn't that easy pressing?
These blocks go together really fast.
This is really good.
I expect to see quilts from all next month.
Quilts from everybody. Okay, so now I'm at the bottom of the page, and all I'm going to do is cut 2 4.5-inch sections for each block, every one. So I'm just going to square off that end. You do have an inch to screw up. Isn't that good?
Yeah.
Everybody needs at least an extra inch. And it doesn't amount to much. There we go. Done?
Yeah.
Yep. Cute. Huh? Now you have 2. Cool. All right. So now we're going to turn the page. We're just flipping through. We've got our bigger pieces now. We still have a 2.5 by 10. But now on each side, we have the 7 by 10. 7 by 10. We're going to flip it right sides together. Ta-da! And just do exactly the same thing. See, it really goes good stripping at its best. So, you know, we were talking about the modern quilter and how it all came about. Sue said it's been going around for 15 years, but they attribute these things to the modern quilter. Just think about the change in your home. You know, how you might be addressing your home. You might have gone to IKEA or to Target and got some of those really, you know, fine lines of furniture. Simple lines, really simple. And you might be doing your home different. So, of course, you don't want to make a quilt, you know, that looks real old-fashioned. You want it to look modern with your furniture, right? Well, then they found out there were these modern quilters all around the country, and they had their digital cameras and their blogs and all of this social media as a way of starting to communicate with each other. So they just started sharing all these different things. Here, you got to have that. So I pulled out, I found this catalog or this magazine. It is McCall's Quilting. And McCall's Quilting, this is fairly recent. They have this whole article. It said, Inside the Modern Quilt Movement. I go, okay, I got to read about it. And so right here it says, and forgive me if I say this wrong, but I think it's Denise Schmidt, who they are referring to as the founder of the modern quilting. And she did a log cabin. Is that not funny? I'm going, oh, no, they've got a new queen, and I'm wondering if I have to give up my crown. I'm the crown of the strippers, the queen of the strippers, right? But anyhow, I just thought that was interesting. But this is definitely a very modern-looking quilt, isn't it? Very modern-looking. So
it's just like a different interpretation the same designs, because they do the same things we've been doing for a long time.
It is.
The log cabin.
And I'm just looking. Okay, Linda. Linda's mom, your mom, walked into my house. I had a bed turning. And she walked in and looked around, and she said, oh, you have a real old-fashioned-looking house. I mean, I do. And so old-fashioned quilts look really good in my house, right? And in my log home, the quilts from the 1800s really look good in my house. So I think if you have the kind of house that you've updated it, you know, then you want to put something modern-looking in it. Okay, so I'm just trimming off the salvage edge right here, and I'm just going to get rid of it. So you know that our mother of quilting in America, as we know it today, is Marie Webster, who wrote her book Quilts in 1909. She's called the mother of quilting in America as we know it today. Think back, 1909. So she looked at her mother's quilts in the attic, and she said, I don't want to make quilts like my mother's. I don't want to make quilts like my mother's. And so she completely changed the whole way quilting looks. She went to the applique florals, the beautiful pieces, and she just changed everything. You know how they look through the 30s and the 40s? So now we're up to 15 years ago.
Right.
And they're saying, I don't want my house to look like my mother's house. So then there's a whole new interpretation of it. Right?
Right. This is one circle.
It is. It's going
full. That you say, my son says, I don't want to publish books like my mother's.
We didn't discuss this, Orion.
Write the will.
Oh, yeah, Brenda. Gone. The Eleanor A. Burns family trust.
It's kind of like a fabric.
Gone.
Trust. I think it's more of a fabric trust.
Fabric trust, yeah. Yeah. So this is the way the block is going to look. Okay, see how? Actually, I should have it turned. But these are the sides, right? These are the sides. So I'm going to flip these right sides together, and then right here, they're going to go right sides together, okay? And I'm going to sew the sides on first, huh? Okay, well, I'm going to tell you about Orion while I sew this.
Uh-oh. This wasn't part of our script.
Yeah, no, we didn't plan this, but since he's poking fun at me, he took his girlfriend to my house, one day, I was not there. I was out traveling. He took his girlfriend to my house, and he shared with me their visit to my house. He said, do you ever think about how all of a sudden, one day, you meet a girl just like your mother? And I go, I don't know, Ryan, how does that go? And he said, well, Mom, Teresa likes sock monkeys just like you do.
And that glass, depression glass.
Oh, she loves depression glass. She collects depression glasses. But now they're married. And so guess what I get for birthdays? Pink depression glass. She just gave me a white milk glass, little creamer and pitcher. So it's really easy to figure out. And I gave her some of my mother's 1930s depression glass because I thought she would really treasure it. And all the time I'm thinking, oh, good, there's going to be somebody that's really going to appreciate all that stuff when I'm gone. I keep on thinking, oh, Teresa, she'll know what to sell it at. For years, when I purchase an antique quilt, I leave the price tag attached because I always say, okay, well, when I'm gone, I want my sons to know how much I paid for this. But anyhow, I always figure Teresa's going to be good for that.
I bet Orion has a good idea of what you pay for it.
Credit card statements.
All right, so now all we're going to do is just press the other way. You like this book? Oh, thank you, Brenda.
Thank you.
Do you like it?
Yes.
This is easy, huh?
Yes.
And you saw all of the different fabrics. You can do your own interpretation. It doesn't have to be like your mother's. How many of you actually had a mother that did quilt? I'm real curious. Yeah, I know. Some of you. That's terrific. A great-grandmother. Great-grandmother. So see, now this piece is going to go. This is actually the top and the bottom. And you're just going to flip right sides together. And honestly, I did not sit and stress that all these lines were going to line up, that I had to get everything in the middle. I just did it. Isn't that fun that you don't have to stress?
No stressing.
No stressing. No stressing. All right. So we are nearly done with this. And the size of it is actually approximately 15 and a half inches. 15 and a half inches. So it's really going to be cool. We've got 12 of them. So now we have 2.5-inch lattice that we are going to cut to the measurement of the block, okay? And one more turn. Done. And how am I doing? Oh, we're doing good. Okay, so let me finish this. And now I'm going to pull out my fussy cuts. Maybe you could do that, Sue. Could you find my fussy cut stuff? I think it's laying, yeah, cool, yeah,
this
my fussy cut
like
stuff, my fussy cut stuff.
Oop. We got it?
All right, so I did show you one that had that fussy cut right in the middle. It really helps if you have a 4.5-inch fussy cut square, 4.5-inch fussy cut square, and Ellie Ann is really good for fussy cuts. There's a number of pieces that have great fussy cuts. Ta-da! So you're just going to press away from that square. Perfect. All right, fussy cuts.
Cecile also has quilts on the ground that are fussy cut
too. Yeah, oh, we do.
I do have my fussy cut.
We do. Let me just show you what I decided. This is the fussy cut that I made in my quilt. It had, that's the bottom. That's the bottom right there. And these are the 2-inch strips around it. I did the green. And because I wanted to cut the same flower over and over again, I put Invisigrip on my ruler. And then I took a permanent marking pen and I laid it right on there. And I traced my outline.
So is the Invisigrip on the top of the ruler?
You could have it, you could put it on both sides. You mark the top, of course. This is the IdentiPen, the permanent marking pen. And you could put it on the bottom so it didn't slide. Okay, so you just rough cut. Ooh, look at the blue. Ooh. Okay, so there's the blue. You rough cut around it. You take your ruler, you take your fussy cut ruler, and you line it up so that you end up with the same one.
Right?
Right? This is on our turnable mat, our little yellow mat that I'm in love with. And it's perfect for fussy cuts because it's really easy to cut up and across, and then you don't pick up anything.
And
you
since
just
we're not on PBS, you can say that it's made by Fiskar.
It's made by Fiskar. And see, I completely turned it all around and then just cut up the right and across again. And that's your fussy cut. Isn't that cute?
Yay.
It's so cute. And then let's see how the block looks. So make sure, this is what I did. And then your sides are going to go on. Look how pretty. Pink. Pink. I'm a real pink girl. I'm a pink or red girl. And then this one is going to go like this on top. And like that on the bottom.
Yay.
Ta-da! Thank you. Okay, you want to show your fussy cuts? And I'm going to pick this up. Oh, yes, that's coming up.
Oh, she's getting on her square.
Get on your mark.
Okay, this is a line called Marguerite, and it's from Riley Blake. And I thought it had really cute little fussy cuts. I just had fat quarters, so I didn't have enough yardage to get 12 fussy cuts out of the same fabric, but I figure I could just alternate between the pink and the yellow, right? So I just kind of sort of auditioned to see what would go with what the best.
Yay.
Yeah, I thought it was real fun.
Let me see the back too.
Oh, we're going to get into the back. Did you want to talk about the back now?
Well, I was going to talk about laying out your quilt. Do you want to see how the
we're
blocks look together?
I'm going to explain about it.
Hold on to it. We're going to move right along real quick. Okay,
we'll
so now we want to take this down. And Patty, you have to stay with me, okay?
Oh.
And pull out the box down right there. Okay, so laying it out, and so this is what we did, we've got to do this really quick. When I did my quilt, I laid out my fussy cuts first, and Eric, you're going to show that on screen, how I put out all my fussy cuts. You had to plan it. Oh, Eric!
You might not be.
There! Okay, see how I laid all my fussy cuts out on the design wall. And then I played with it. And first, then I added all my darks. See the darks? And I always like to think of a triangle placement. See, it kind of went triangle, went over placement and back. And there were four, so I did four. And then I put in the mediums. And again, I did a triangle placement. And then I took the leftover spots and I just filled it in with the light. And then I put last. I love this fast forward, don't you? This goes really good. Then I put in all the lattice in between it. The lattice is all cut the size as the block. And then the cornerstones next. And then it was just sewing vertical rows together. Vertical rows together. But I pulled some out, and Teresa said, okay, maybe Sue, you can hold them, and Patty can quickly arrange them. We were working in the sewing room, and I said, Patty, stay with me. Help me put out my blocks. And she did. So she's going to do pretty much a triangle arrangement. I put the darkest ones on the top, and it would be really cool if we only had three, but we have four. So you just start putting dark ones out, and Teresa goes, I don't have a sister. I have to do my own. Okay, so this was just another line that I had a lot of fun with. Okay, this is cool. So if you think about a triangle, we went triangle like this. And now I'm starting a triangle with some dark greens that I had. I love this. Now, when we're done, we're just going to let it up there. And we don't quite have room to put it all on here, but that's good. Okay, so she's going to balance the dark green up there, down over here, and move that down. Yeah, we're doing good. And now we're getting into the softer blues.
I like that.
So now you see we've got places to just go ahead and fill in with the softer ones. And what I like to do is make sure that you put different prints beside each other. You don't want to make one area real heavy with the same color. You want to make sure that you mix it up. And it really helps if you squint. You can always tell a quilter because you're squinting at your work. And now she's got it on the bottom row. How are we doing? Okay, now she's kind of creating a triangle. Up there.
Up here.
Oh, but no. Why not? Why not?
No,
it's too much the same. Yeah, but that one's pretty.
You like this one?
I love that one because another thing, she picked one with blue. I'll take this one. Blue and green. And because I like to kind of go from one color to the next, too. That blue has a little bit of green in it. How we doing? That looks pretty, huh? This is really fun. I just found this in my stash. It was really exciting. Okay, where to go?
This one.
Oh.
Here. You like that?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We only have two.
Okay, almost done.
Two more. Oh, dear. That's cool.
Oh, they're all blue. No.
They're all blue. I had more blue.
I like
but now.
There.
Okay, and one. Oh, I think that'll be good in there because it's so dark.
Oh, yeah.
That's perfect.
Yeah.
There you go.
That's perfect.
Well done.
That's very good. You guys would be lucky if you had a sister too.
Yeah.
That used to be an artist. She, you know, they probably ask if she's was an artist, and they ask me, did I used to be a teacher? So we always go back. Okay, so then you're just going to put your lattice in and sew your whole top together. And we're just like fast forwarding right into, keep on going, into the backing. Ta-da! And now you get to show your backing.
All right. So those of you that know me know that I always like to piece my backs. So I use up all my leftover fabrics. And I just wanted to talk a little bit about it. The picture that you actually see on your pattern, remember those leftover pieces that Eleanor had from cutting her blocks? Okay, those are all, you know, 10 inches wide and approximately by 14 inches. So I just piece those all together, and that's what's on the back of the cover quilt. But this one's a little bit more typically what I do. What you want to do, you want to start with your smallest pieces and piece them together. All the time that you do that, you want to be really conscious that you want to keep your straight grain all going in the same direction. Don't put a straight grain going this way and a straight grain going this way. Then it starts getting a little wobbly, and then either you quilt it or you send it out to a quilter, they're going to be excited if they get that. So anyway, so you start small, and then I'll just take and kind of add and do my links, and then I'll do like a long column of piece, and that's my most piecework is going to be down the middle of my quilt. My larger pieces, then I'll go ahead and do for my two sides. You always want to make sure that you have at least 6 inches from the last piece out, okay, so that the quilter's not going to run into a seam right along the edge of your quilt top. So I always make sure I have at least 2 going in and another 4, because I know Amy likes, or Judy likes to have at least 4 inches along the outside. So that's basically how you do it. It's a straight grain, and I wrote a little reminder sheet in there just of how to do that. But I think it's really fun. This quilt started as one of those towers. And there's nothing left of my tower. So that was really fun, right? Yeah.
So you get to buy all new fabric.
I buy 2 for 1 then, you know? So anyway, but that's how it works. And don't forget to put your label on the back.
Oh.
So.
Label on the back.
Cool.
And you have one more quilt. Oh. This the one that had the... the pink one is gone, huh? That's okay. And Patty, yeah?
Yeah, Patty has a variation.
She has a variation. She never does what I say.
Okay. So, Sue.
Teresa, you and I can hold this.
Very different, isn't it?
On your blue spot.
So this was Sue's suggestion. She said, well, you could use two different fabrics for your lattice. So I did a white, and then I couldn't resist that Elle's periwinkle. And these were all leftovers from my Honey Honey quilt. I used only the warm colors on the other quilt, and then I had the cools left over. And you can see there's two different grid patterns that are kind of interwoven, more of a complex design. Something else you probably noticed. You remember the original block. Show that original block. The four quadrants, ta-da! Same fabric, but I decide, I want to do four different fabrics.
Oh, like right here.
Yeah, so this is the one block, and I just laid it out. I cut my pieces to size. I laid it all out, and then I actually assembly line sewed it together, too. If you can picture, I just took, this was my first unit where I lined them all up. I just stacked them from the bottom to the top, and then I assembly line sewed this row, and then I assembly line sewed this stack, and it went together, made it in a day and a half.
So, yeah.
Yes, I did. Good eye. I did. Instead of the 2.5, I cut my lattice 2 inches. I wanted it to be consistent with the center square.
Cool.
So, yeah. So, and I love it. The colors are so relaxing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Very nice.
Thank you. Cool. Very nice. And as the words go, quilt and bind as desired. But Sue has some quilting suggestions for you. She did more than quilted as desired. She planned it out.
Well, actually, I didn't quilt it at all.
Oh, yes.
But
she quilted with her checkbook. I'm my credit card.
Yeah. But I did have a certain idea what I wanted to do with this quilt. And I wanted to do like a sampler of different kind of quilting motifs that you could do on it. In the modern quilting, they do a lot of things designed like from nature, like water or wood grains and things like that. And you'll see that going around in the lattice. And they do a lot of things from architecture as well. So I had
it looks like pebbles.
Like little pebbles in the stream. There are a lot of straight lines and zigzags. I'm going to turn it over because I think you can see the threads a lot better from the back.
Very cute. Ooh.
So we'll just start with this first block up here. And this, as you can see, it's just based on squares, interlocking squares. Modern quilters, they don't care if you overlap. You remember when we began stippling, it's like, you can't cross over that line. It doesn't matter. Okay, so we don't have to worry about that rule.
Thank heavens.
Right. And this is this kind of a fun little like starburst that comes out, coming back to a central location to kind of pull all the quilting together. And I love this little one. This little one where you come down and do a little loop-de-loop and go on and loop-de-loop. You see that a lot.
A loop-de-loop.
And this is kind of, are you guys familiar with McTavish? It's almost like a noun now. This lady, you know, Karen McTavish, she kind of came up with this style. It's like McTavish, but it's more open. So it's not that quite tight feeling that you see. And that's always a nice zigzags. I mean, I could probably do that. I mean, I would feel confident doing that. And then finally, I wanted to show you just this really cute little loop within a loop.
So that's very, very cute.
Yeah, so I thought it was fun.
It is very different too, isn't it?
Yeah, it's just a different look. It's not the traditional feathers, which I still love traditional feather work, but it's just something new. You know, I just get tired of doing the same old thing all the time. But so I just wanted to give you some ideas. There's some great books out there on just different styles of the quilting you can use. You might really, I don't know if you have that, Brenda. I know your quilting. So I wanted to share that with you. Yeah, yeah, you can see what she was talking about, the consistent of the density, so you don't have one place that's really tight and another place that's really loose. And that's always important, whether modern style or not modern style, I think.
So you can tell we're winding down.
We're winding down.
For hole in the wall and the baker's dozen. Yay. Thank you. Woo! Cool. So I didn't get to ask if we were going to put this all on video of all of your quilts that you shared. Are we going to do that now? Are you going to record it?
Yeah.
I think that next time we should put it first and before I even come in, don't you? Anyhow, I want to know who did this quilt. Oh, yes, I remember I was watching you. Would you say your name? And you can even stand up.
I'm Marge Cutler.
Yes.
She needs a mic.
Oh. Were you impressed with the show?
Yes.
Sitting around, did you like the quilts? I think it's really nice to see all the quilts. All right, so just tell us about it. You can just stay in 2 seconds. It's fine.
Okay, I'm Marge Huntwork,
and I call it the Zigzag Valentine.
Perfect! It's done in time. It's done in time. I think pass it to Linda. This is yours, right, Linda?
Yes, Linda Carlson.
Okay. This is Linda's. Is that beautiful?
I used a jelly roll from Moda called So Stitchy, and I call it zigged when I should have zagged because I made one little boo-boo on the upper left-hand corner.
Not supposed to tell anybody.
But that's what makes it interesting because I zigged when I should have zagged. Thank you.
She zigged when she should have zagged. It's really pretty, though. I really like it.
Yeah.
Very, very nice, Linda. That's cool. And my name is Eleanor Burns, and this is my quilt. But there is a mistake that I made, too. Teresa was sitting and looking at it, and she pointed it out. Not on this one. It's on the other one. Not on this one. It's another one that I made.
It's Fellowship.
Okay,
Moda Fellowship.
It was, yeah, Fellowship, Moda Fellowship. But I really enjoyed it. And I can't remember who did this one. This was Teresa.
Teresa just did that.
Teresa. Okay, cool. Teresa's quilt. And you did see that one. Here, this is Teresa's. That was the last time.
Don't switch.
There we go. To Teresa's and
Diana Edgman
is in,
as you can see,
the
back.
Oh my gosh, that's the evening, one of the evening students. She loves Kansas Troubles. She loves Kansas Troubles,
and that's Marilyn Belt is the next one. Oh. She's going to tell you all about it.
Marilyn,
my name's Marilyn, and the fat quarters were purchased here.
Yay.
And it's skinny and long because it's a Project Linus quilt, so it's got fleece on the back, so it's nice and snuggly.
Oh, that's nice.
There we go. I missed what you said, Marilyn. You said it's for...
Oh, Project Linus.
Project Linus. Isn't that fantastic for Project Linus? I just think that is so cute.
Yes, talk about
that's so cute. And
okay,
some of you have been hiding your quilts.
Wait, we have one more.
Oh, one more?
It's Marie's.
And where is Marie's? Oh, my goodness, there's Marie's. It's so sweet. Look at that. And I don't know, maybe, Ryan can get it. Rick could get it. It's this one right over here. Okay, Marie, go for it.
This one, my daughter's expecting, and her baby, the colors is yellow and gray for the nursery, so this just happened to be the one. And she wants chevrons. So I thought the zigzag is close to chevrons and modern.
Yep, perfect.
And she loved it.
I did the lesson just for you.
I just cut my own, and then it's got Minky on the back.
Oh, perfect. Cool. Look at the...
Oh, huh? They're trying to switch to you.
Switch to me. Look forward.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm so excited. Look at this. The whole front row. Oh, my goodness, there's three of you. Are you ready?
Okay.
Okay. Stand up, jump up, smile, show your quilt. Aww. Turn around. You can all do it together. And show.
Okay, we're going to come over here.
Where do you want me to go?
Cobble on over here.
Okay, I'll hobble.
I have more directors in this audience.
Okay, Aiko, we're going to come back here. It's your turn.
Oh, my gosh.
Really messy.
I
know.
How very nice. Yay. Cool. So if we want, do we want more people lining up on the edge to just move to that spot?
Can you help me hold one end and then they can talk about their quilt?
Yeah, go along the outside if you can.
Yeah, on the blue.
That's cool. Oh, wow, Linda.
Okay, watch the corn.
I have a linen cupboard on the landing of my second story, and it's all full of Oriental memorabilia for my husband and son. So this is made of scraps. This is all fabric
that
pieces
is gorgeous.
And ends.
Very
pretty. That's it.
That is beautiful.
And it's two table runners together. It's two table runners.
Two of them. That is really nice. I really like it. Oh, look at that.
I made it a little smaller, so it was a little tricky trying to work it out. But I like the bright colors and batiks.
Really nice.
It's going to a fundraiser for Kiwanis in Fallbrook. So.
And notice she didn't put
Sandy
any
Buckley.
Borders on. And that is one of the things with the modern quilters, too. No borders. Saves fabric. Yeah. Cool. Eloise.
All right, Eloise.
Oh, my gosh.
I think it looks better up and down.
Oh, my gosh, that's gorgeous. That is beautiful.
Hello.
Well, black and red and white is my favorite. And but I have to say that it was so bright that it confused my eyes, and I had a hard time putting this thing together. So it's a good thing you gave us the count thing, because I could not have done it otherwise.
That is great.
So, all right.
That is great, though. Are there more in these rows behind? Oh, the overachievers always sit in the front. You can tell. Nobody in this section? No more? Oh, my goodness. All right. How about this section? Well, we had two of them that are already hanging up. You two. Oh, you three. I knew you guys wouldn't disappoint me. Four. All right. So maybe if you can all kind of, oh, look. Oh, my gosh. I'm so excited.
Yeah, we're going to do a line this way.
Yeah.
We'll
did you want to come? You can. You could, if you can
necklace.
Go around, maybe go this way and go behind.
All
yeah,
right.
Go that way.
So you go
and
on
go
this
behind.
Square.
Oh,
square.
Wow.
All right.
That is great, Nancy.
It's really pretty. Introduce yourself.
Okay. I'm Nancy Sandoval, and I was going to do this in lime green and purple, but I was going to hand paint some fabric to go in this particular stripe, and when I walked into a fabric shop, I found lime green and pink, so I changed my mind.
That's beautiful.
And I didn't have to hand paint it either.
That's very nice.
That is really nice. That is great. Cool.
Right.
And is it candy or sandy?
Sandy.
Or Sandy.
There's a lot of those here.
Yes, thank you. I think this is the first time you're showing your quilt.
My first time.
Your first time. Ooh.
I bought this here also. The last month with the. Everybody had this one.
That's
there.
Okay.
Yeah, that's all right.
But you got.
Yeah, I love it.
Fun.
Yeah.
Really
so fun. Sandy Corbin from Beach Cities. We're all together, kind of.
Very fun.
Yeah.
Oh, that was really great. And Teresa, that's with the red border on it.
That's why I did it. You showed that, and that's why
the
I did
the red border. Cool. That's
we
really
have
nice.
Any fabric, ladies. If well, you want red border blouse.
That is here really nice.
So this is actually left over from 2 years ago when we did the strip club.
Uh-huh.
So I went into my Christmas fabric, and I had just enough left to make this.
You know, it's very nice. Very, very nice. Very, very cute. Very good. Thank you. And Eileen?
Yeah, you gotta start on my blue square.
Whoa. Yes. I think I recognize these.
These are leftover materials out of my...
Yeah.
But I'm still in my brown mode.
In your brown mode.
Very nice.
Yeah, that is really nice. Very attractive. And when you look in the TV, look in the monitor. It's different whenever you look at it in the monitor and you really see it. It's really, really beautiful. Good job. Cool. All right, Missy.
I had all these track quarters and I said, nah, they wouldn't work. So I bought a jelly roll here.
Here you go. You need the mic.
Okay.
Wow.
I bought a jelly roll here, and I took out the black because it just made it too dark, and I had some in. I went through my stash. I actually went through it, and I found a blue that would complement it in a lighter, and I put it through.
It's very nice.
Thank you.
That's very nice. It looks really great. You did a good job. I like your triangles on the outside, too. It seems like you're repeating that. Very nice. Ooh, very good. Nancy, I'm very excited to see you stand here. Woo! Very nice.
I've just been looking for something to do with my blue and white collection, so.
It's very nice. And look in the monitor. Look how beautiful it looks.
Yeah, see on
that. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You guys can see that way. I keep forgetting. Really nice.
Yay.
Great. Cool. Anybody else in the back row? No? Clear in the back row? Good. Did we get everybody? Did you all eat your cookie?
Yes.
I get the what's left back.
Or no,
I have
cookie
to stay
for you.
Closer to the table. So, happy Valentine's Day, everybody. You have a good time.
Yes.
So, I think you're all going to get your hole in the wall done, right?
Yes.
Easy.
Thank you.